The Advanced Tech Podcast, providing a spotlight for innovators and disruptors. For links and show notes, and to find out how to sponsor the Advanced Tech Podcast, go to advancedtechmedia.org. You can also find and sponsor us on Patreon. If you're listening to us on iTunes, Google Play, or Spotify, please take a moment to subscribe and give us a rating. You can also sponsor us using Bitcoin at advancedtechmedia.org/sponsor. Welcome to the Advanced Tech Podcast. Joining me today is Chris Wood, who's Chief Operating Officer at Pixelmatic. Welcome, Chris.
Hi, Alexandra. It's very, very nice to be here. Thanks for having me on.
So before we get into Pixelmatic and what you do there, let's talk a little bit about your background and how you got into the space.
Sure. Well, I've been a big gamer since I was like 4 years old. Like I'm like a big sort of game nerd, I suppose. But professionally, I've been in sort of operations roles for almost a decade. I moved to China 10 years ago. And I was actually working in some training institutions, being responsible for like 50 or so different centers across China, rolling out various platforms like training platforms, courses, animations, apps, and all this kind of thing. And really, I pivoted to the video game industry, which was something of a dream of mine since I was a kid, when I met Samson. Right. So obviously, you know, Samson Mo, I'm sure a lot of your listeners do too, who's the CSO at Blockstream. Mm-hmm. And yeah, when I met him, I was actually already working at Pixelmatic part time as a game designer, just to kind of helping out because I was introduced to someone on the team. But then I ended up having a coffee with Samson, went to a Starbucks with him, and he kind of laid out his vision for this game that he was building, Infinite Fleet. And just from the moment he spoke about it, was absolutely hooked. It was a game that I'd always really wanted as a gamer. You know, it was a big, big dream for me. So after that meeting, the next day, I quit my old job and pivoted straight into to be a project manager at Pixelmatic and to drive Infinite Fleet, which, and ever since, it's been one hell of a whirlwind.
So you're a chief operating officer at Pixelmatic. Yes. What's that like?
Yeah, I mean, it's obviously, I think a COO, obviously, and I think with many COOs, you really have to wear a lot of hats. You have to be very flexible, very versatile. No day is really the same. And a lot of my job, of course, is parsing Samson's vision of the game and kind of making sure that that pipeline works, that those workflows are all going on. And to be honest, for the past year, a lot of my job has mostly been kind of investor relations as well. So we're raising money for the game right now. And obviously a lot of my job has been that, as well as kind of, you know, making sure that the team is operating at full efficiency, making sure that everyone's motivated and that we're making just a fantastic game. So yeah, it's really a very wide ranging role, a very, very challenging, but awesome. Absolutely love this job because it's just, like I say, no 2 days are the same and it's just very exciting.
So I'm curious, what is Samson like to have as a boss?
Yeah, well, no, Samson, I've got to say, he's an absolutely fantastic boss because you know what? I'll be honest. When I first started at Pixelmatic, it was challenging for me because Samson's got a really, really high bar, like an extremely high bar. Mm-hmm. He's a very technically orientated, very, very detail orientated guy. And I had to raise my bar in order to match his standard. And so obviously that took me out of my comfort zone. And I think made me grow as a person. And me and Samson have a really fantastic relationship. And I believe that the objectives he has, I'm now very, very capable of kind of helping him to achieve, right? And to get to that point was a challenge, but we're kind of in good lockstep and it's all been really exciting, so.
Very cool.
but in TLDR there, challenging, but great.
Nice. It's always better to be challenged when you're working on a project or when you're delivering something. It's just, yeah, if you're sitting there and you're bored and you're kind of counting your hours, that's no fun. Absolutely. Nobody wants to do that. So let's talk a little bit about what Pixelmatic is doing and Infinite Fleet and what's happening with the game, kind of where you're at with development, what people can expect soon.
Sure. Well, I mean, it's very exciting because we just launched our alpha a couple of weeks ago. Mm-hmm. And even then, I mean, this alpha is It's very small. It's you know, it's quite narrow in scope in the start, where it's mostly a networking demo to get people on there and make sure that everything's running smoothly. There's obviously lots of bugs and things, but we're dropping releases every month or so. But to sort of wind back, really, Infinite Fleet is a spades game. It's a massively multiplayer online game, which means there's going to be millions of players playing online together, with a strategy element as well. So Samson's background came from a company called Relic, which were developing strategy games, real-time strategy games like Dawn of War and Company of Heroes, which he personally was working on, and is one of the highest rated strategy games on Metacritic. It's really incredible. Relic had this, they were always innovating new things, you know? And so now the strategy game genre is kind of stagnated a little bit. And so Samson wanted to come in and kind of shake everything up. So we got this AAA dev team from just these incredible studios to shake up the whole genre and make something really fresh. And it's really, really fantastic in a whole bunch of ways. And one thing that really excited about me, and how I was really pulled in, you know, as we were speaking, was we are doing this thing called a directed narrative. So gamers, when you play a massive big, you know, online game like this, you kind of have this second identity. You know, you hear about people on World of Warcraft and they kind of live their life in these games, you know, these huge things. Mm-hmm. But you really want to matter when you play these games. You know, you want to have an impact on these virtual worlds. And we're driving that to a super high level because we are basically branching storylines based on what the players do. So an example I like to take is if the aliens that we're fighting, the Aatrox, if they come to Earth and try to destroy it, the whole community of players have to come and fight back. And if they fail, then Earth could be destroyed forever and the whole storyline of the game just does a tectonic shift. Mm-hmm. So that's something that we're really excited about with this.
Very cool. I like the outer space theme. That's something I'm personally very interested in. So that's cool.
Awesome. You're a space fan then. Have you been following everything that's going on with SpaceX and everything? It's really exciting.
I mean, it's hard not to. I dabble in writing. So there's a short fiction book that I'm starting.
Amazing.
So released. Yeah, it's an adventure. It's actually the project that I was working on earlier this morning. So
wonderful. Well, you should get in contact with our team, Alexandra.
All right. Yeah, one kind of chapter excerpt is out on Citadel 21 in the January edition, so volume 9. And it's just, it's a very far future kind of story that brings Bitcoin into the mix in a way where it's just a natural thing, where it just, of course, exists 300 years from now.
Yeah, that's not too far in the future, I don't think, Alexandra. Yeah, we've got one thing as well in our game. We've got these concepts of these sort of sovereign, not nations as such, but like these you know, intergalactic communities as such, called citadels. So nice. That's something that's yeah, we're gonna, you know, we put some Easter eggs in there.
That's awesome. Nice. Well, I look forward to seeing more of the game development, the story development, and I like the fact that you can, you know, change that narrative, and it really is dependent on, you know, user-driven actions. And it kind of sounds like almost like a choose your own adventure, but in the digital format. Would that be a good way to put it?
That's a great way to put it. That's an analogy I often put, you know, when we were kids, like just those little turn to page 42 or something. It's just, they were so much fun. I never finished one successfully, to be fair. I was always a bit rubbish at those, but never mind. But you know, I see another thing. I mean, one of the main features of this game that's really exciting is actually the crypto element of it, right? And this is something that we are extremely excited about, because as far as we can see, no other game has done this, right? We're actually integrating a Bitcoin-backed cryptocurrency throughout the game. Mm-hmm. So in traditional, these online multiplayer games, players spend, as I say, hours and hours and hours of their lives building, you know, in our case, spaceships and things like that. And in Infinite Fleet, you'll be rewarded with an INF currency, it's called, by taking part in these big events and things. And with that currency, you're able to trade peer-to-peer digital items that you've built. So you could spend, if you imagine, you know, years building up an incredible fleet of spaceships, and then be able to actually extract real value from those by playing the game and extracting that crypto to your your digital wallet, giving that portability to players. This is something we haven't seen. Obviously, there's been a lot of NFT models, which are the big thing these days, of course. And we are doing NFTs as well. I mean, it's huge at the moment, isn't it? It's incredible, the NFT movement right now. Mm-hmm. But we strongly believe in this crypto sort of model for the currency of the game, and to embrace peer-to-peer trade and player-driven economies within our game. We're very excited to see where that goes.
Very cool. And if memory serves me correctly, it's being issued on Liquid. Is that correct?
The Liquid Network? Correct, indeed. Yes. So we're, you know, again, that's something great for us to work on. That a lot of the projects out there are working on Ethereum and so forth. But Bitcoin, of course, is the most battle-tested code base, right? And we are, of course, strong proponents of Bitcoin. At the end of the day, I work for Samson Mount, right? So we are all very, very strong proponents of Bitcoin in this team. We do believe in the future of Bitcoin and what Liquid and Lightning can do. And we're going to be exploring all the different avenues that Blockstream are kind of giving us on that front. Because there's a lot that we can play with, and especially with these peer-to-peer transactions. You know, there's Lightning, of course. We can use atomic swaps, we can use multi-sig wallets, so that even like these guilds of players, they can start their own little corporations and hold multi-sig wallets for their assets as well. Mm-hmm. Which it's just going to be a whole new economic, I don't know, experiment. You know, it's going to be really exciting indeed.
So let's talk a little bit about Bitcoin and what you see in the Bitcoin space. What excites you? Why are you here, and what keeps you in Bitcoin?
Well, you know what? I'm just going to be totally honest and open. I was massively indoctrinated when I came into Pixelmatic because I was surrounded by Bitcoiners. I had no idea what it was when I first came in. I'd never even heard of it. So I joined in 2016, Pixelmatic. And then I, you know, slowly but surely started to learn about it, like I'm sure like yourself and like every other Bitcoiner out there. You know, you kind of go down the rabbit hole a little bit, don't you? You take that orange pill, and mm-hmm. Now it's very, very exciting indeed. It's certainly very, very exciting indeed now. I think it's really just the same as what most people feel, really. It's just that idea that you can control your own finance, right? You don't have that middleman as such. And also just, I live in China, right? So transferring money to back home to the UK, it's just such a challenge. So Bitcoin obviously really helps me on that front. And just the excitement around the crypto community is really incredible. I'm only really just sort of kind of jumping in there since Infinite Fleet's been getting more traction, and I've started to interact with a lot more people in the crypto community. So I would say I'm kind of a noob. I'm not going to lie. I'm kind of a noob on that front, but I'm getting more and more excited, and it's been really incredible to obviously see my finances grow a little bit, and to join the community and all these wonderful people with such incredible insights. So it's just been very exciting for me, and I'm always learning more.
I think that's a really cool, humble attitude to have, especially since you've been involved since, you know, 2016, or at least have known about it. There's sort of that, you know, the class of 2017 where it had the big spike, and then, you know, these are kind of like the new hodlers and plebs. And
yeah, so I just don't touch it. You know, I just leave it there. I don't trade. I don't do anything. My approach is just dollar cost averaging. I buy every month, despite the price, doesn't matter, every month. Try to find a good dip if possible, you know, but generally speaking, buy every month and just keep going. And so far that's worked extremely well for me since I started towards the end of 2016. Yeah.
Nice. Yeah, it's very smart. It's a good strategy. You know, you see where the price of Bitcoin is now, and like, yeah, I mean, a year ago, like, not even, it was around 5,000 or 6,000. So
I know, it's incredible. And that was, I mean, it was hard, but I didn't sell at that time. I sold once, and I was really irritated by that because it was just out of necessity. We had a big purchase that we just had to do. And I had to liquidate a bunch of Bitcoin, and I'm just so gutted about that because it was quite a bit at the time. And it was around that time. It was like a year ago when it was about 5,000. I think, oh, so upsetting, but never mind. Mm-hmm. These things happen. Just keep stacking sats.
That's true. We really are so early. You know, it's people think I've missed it. And, you know, what I see, what's kind of a shame is you start seeing people thinking, well, you know, Bitcoin's too expensive. Like, what else can I buy? Not realizing that it's a fixed and finite asset. So
Exactly. The thing that's been exciting me recently is just that now I say I'm a noob. I'd say I've graduated from noob status to kind of in the middle, I guess. But I've started to orange pill some of my friends, you know. I think that's when you really start becoming a bit of a Bitcoiner, you know. And it's been great because I did a video a little when it was just hit 20K. And a friend of mine who was a no coiner at the time we did a video of the transaction, and now she's up 3x and she's super excited, and she's, you know, on Twitter and everything. She lives in Lagos, so it was a very interesting place to be as well for that. And I just love that feeling. It's just so awesome to spread the word and to watch other people get so excited, right? It's just an incredible place to be.
It is. The whole conversation about Bitcoin, like, you start questioning the money and then you start questioning so many other things. It's really interesting to see how people kind of unfold the more that they find out about Bitcoin.
Absolutely. Absolutely. And I've got Samson to thank about that, I've got to say. You say, what's it like working for Samson? Yeah, you made me happier.
That's awesome. Yeah, he's a really good guy.
Yeah, he is. He is indeed.
So let's talk, let's switch back to Pixelmatic, and maybe let's talk about some of the challenges in like the earlier days. What's like a big pivot that your team had to make?
We were innovating on so many fronts, right? I can talk about it in a moment, but we're doing the security token offering, which is very innovative. The game itself is very innovative. We have this crypto thing going through it. So when you're raising money with these different new roads that you're building, in the first place, very hard to raise money, because if you go to traditional gaming VCs, they'll say, oh, it's got crypto, I'm out, you know, or just VCs in general. Oh, security token, what's that? I don't know. You know, and it's very challenging. So luckily, you know, not luckily, but through a lot of hard work, we've really attracted a lot of visionaries to the project. And I think that's what really turned it around. When we had people like Charlie Lee, right, inventor of Litecoin, huge in the space, he really believes in what we're doing. You know, Samson and him have a great working relationship too. They really trust each other really well. Charlie's great. Max Kaiser, Phil Potter, Tether. When all these people started to come in, I just can't tell you how fast the ball's been rolling. The momentum's been supersonic, you know. We went from a team of like 10 people to now we're continuing to hire, and we've got 40 people distributed globally now. We're really starting to make a fantastic product. And as I say, the alpha came out a couple of weeks ago. So it's been a hell of a journey. It's been a really challenging but amazing journey. And I think the team has just put together something incredible. I don't know if you've seen the, you know, videos of the game and whatnot, but every time, you know, the gamers look at it, they just think, wow, this thing looks incredible. The crypto folk look at it and go, oh my God, we can have this peer-to-peer market, the economy is just incredible. We're really, although innovating, it's just super exciting.
So let's talk a little bit about the security token that you're developing. And I understand it's going to be released, instead of on Ethereum, it'll be released on Liquid.
Yeah, it's minted on Liquid, obviously. So pegged to Bitcoin, again, which is always good news. And yeah, I'm not sure how familiar you are with security tokens yourself, but it's really quite interesting, because it's very exciting for most people along the value chain. The regulators, although it's, you know, somewhat slow, the regulations are coming through, but it is, of course, it's fresh, and you know, the SEC doesn't move quickly. But the regulators are very optimistic about it, because it has built-in compliance, right? So if you obviously securitize everything you need from the KYC, the AML, the compliancy procedures for whatever it is that your token's building, then that's great, because it's just so easy to get these things onto exchanges and issuance platforms and so on and so forth. So we are currently, we're doing two raises with this security token, one in an EU-based issuer in Luxembourg with a company called stocker.io. And they've been fantastic. They've really, really helped us through that regulatory minefield and made sure the tokens are compliant on that front. And on the other side in the US, where we're currently applying for regulation A+, which means that non-accredited investors can invest in the token. But the token itself, it's just a security. It's essentially liquid equity, but it's not really any different from, you know, a share certificate, right? Mm-hmm. But it's just because it's got everything built in, it's, you know, it's more frictionless, shall we say. So for us, it offers some dividend, like a net profit dividend, and equity in the company, right? So it's not like the old ICO Wild West days where you just, you know, mint a billion tokens and say, woohoo, we've got trillion market cap, whatever it might be. Mm-hmm. We've got just our shares on blockchain. And that is really, really quite exciting for us, because it's a regulated way for us to raise money while still driving forward a new paradigm in the crypto world, in the cryptoverse as such.
Well, I think this will be one of the first securities released on the Liquid network, I believe. Is that right?
Yeah, one of. One of, absolutely. Like I say, we're treading a lot of new pathways here, you know? I mean, at some point we're going to have to do something more comfortable, really. But we're always getting outside the comfort zone and trying to be the first in a lot of different areas. But you know what? The regulators are coming on board. We're working with, yeah, a whole bunch of regulators in Europe and like I say, in the US. So once that all comes through, it's looking good. And we've announced a partnership with INX as well, so the tokens will be tradable on there, which is very exciting, and we're currently raising money.
So I'm really curious, you mentioned you've got the alpha out now. What new features can gamers look forward to in this current release, and when will your beta be released, and what can people expect?
So the alpha right now, as I said, it's fairly narrow. Basically, you'll have a spaceship, and you get to fly around, of course, and shoot some aliens, you know, with other players. So currently, I think our server limit is 32, but it's constantly expanding. So be able to get together and shoot some aliens together, which is always good fun. But we're releasing every month or two, and we're dropping quite a lot of content. So the next release, one of our big focuses is to make sure that the actual fleet can work together. So it's not just one ship, but you're going to have like five. Which is going to be great. We've just announced that our second trailer is going to be released towards the end of this month, and I can't tell you how awesome it looks. I'm not sure if you're a fan of sort of old 80s cartoons or Transformers or even Rocky, actually, but we have announced that our composer for the soundtrack was a guy called Vince DiCola, who worked on the Transformers 80s movie and Rocky IV. So it's just this kick-ass 80s synthy soundtrack. It's just so cool. So that'll be dropping soon. But the road to beta, yeah, it's looking, it's the end of the year. That's when things are going to be really open to more and more players. We'll have a lot more content, you know, some different zones where people can fly, be able to build more things and whatnot. Like I say, it's going to be a very organic growth where we have releases every month or two with just heaps of content and just continue to expand this game. But it's very playable as it is right now. It's been a long road, and I can't tell you how amazing it felt when that went live. It was just such a huge moment for us because, like I say, we were just concepting this thing out like four years ago, just hand to paper as such, with a very small team indeed, and you know, blood, sweat and tears that have gone into this thing. It's really good to see it out live and people really enjoying it. But hey, that's just the first, not even really the first full step yet. It's we've got a long way to go.
So where can people find this current alpha release, and how can they get involved?
Yeah, dead easy. Just infinitefleet.com. Okay, not infinity. A lot of people say infinity fleet. It's infinitefleet.com. You can go on there. There's two options right now. If you invest in Infinite Fleet via the Stokr, STOKR.io platform, with a minimum of 100 bucks, you can get in that way. Or you can buy a ship on our store. So we're currently selling the spaceships, which will be NFTs, on our store. Actually, in our first week, we sold 300 spaceships in the first week without really any marketing at all. So we were just, that was really, really great. It was a good proof that people were excited about the project, and more are being sold every day. So that's going great. Infinitefleet.com or stokr.io.
And then one of the ways I like to end episodes is to ask if you have any questions for our audience. And if so, how can they reach you?
Okay, so yeah, good one. I guess the real question at the moment is what people think about the NFT movement right now, because it's such a hot topic, right? I mean, it's so huge. I mean, I expect you must have seen Beeple sold his work for millions and millions of dollars. It was huge. Yeah, I guess what do people think about NFTs, and how do you think that fits into such an interactive medium, which is video games, right? Certainly my opinion is that those two go very, very smoothly together indeed. And to reach me, Chris, normal spelling, not the weird K spelling. Sorry for any K Chris's out there. But Chris Wood 1821 on Twitter.
Well, Chris, I really appreciate your time. Thanks for joining me on the show today. I look forward to future releases and wish you all the best for all the game development this year.
Yeah, Alexandra, it was a real pleasure. It's always a lot of fun to talk about Infinite Fleet and Pixelmatic. Thanks for having me. And I hope Samson was satisfied with my response on that question. That was, hot under the collar.
Well, if you're still there next week, you'll know.
I will. Thanks awesome. Very much, Alexandra.
Thanks, Chris.